severe asthma is asthma which needs treatment with high dose inhaled corticosteroids and long acting beta-2 agonist in order to be controlled, or in worst case scenario, even is not well controlled despite this treatment.
Severe asthma presents fairly commonly to respiratory physicians' offices. Severe asthma is probably somewhere between 5 to 10% of all asthma patients. And yet oftentimes, I think respiratory physicians and other physicians may not appreciate that the asthma is indeed severe, or that it is even asthma. There are many times when a patient comes in to see a respiratory physician for problems with their breathing. And if they're a young person, they may just get a diagnosis of asthma or even severe asthma without doing all of the appropriate testing.
A missed diagnosis is a missed opportunity for proper treatment. So you can only treat the patients well if the diagnosis is correct. And since we now have the insights that severe asthma consists of multiple different phenotypes, we need really to make the proper diagnosis of severe asthma and to phenotype the patients well in order to be able to offer them optimal targeted add-on treatments.
Severe asthma, from physicians' perspectives, from the public's perspectives, from the family's perspective, is often categorized as asthma. And we all know that asthma is really kind of a nuisance disease in many cases, and you take your medicines and you're fine. And so they don't talk about it. But they have an enormous burden associated with their disease. They can't do many of the things that patients with milder asthma can do. They suffer the side effects from the medication. So certainly if they're being treated with oral corticosteroids, with prednisolone, that there can be, in fact, a big impact on their body appearance, that they put on weight, that emotionally they're impacted by the drugs and by the stigma of having gained the weight and the physical changes that the corticosteroids actually have on them. So it is an enormously burdensome disease, and yet patients don't often talk about it.
And of course, first things first, the diagnosis of asthma should be confirmed, and second, comorbidities, which can of course influence the severity of asthma, should be addressed and treated appropriately.
Interestingly, when you get to more severe asthma, people die of other related things. They die of pneumonias, they die of infections, they die because, at least in the United States, occasionally you don't have access to medications because they're too expensive. And certainly they can die of the complications of the high doses of corticosteroids that many of these patients are on. And those aspects of asthma deaths from severe asthma are often underappreciated and may not even be collected.
So I get a number of referrals from primary care, from other hospitals, of children with asthma who do not seem to be responding to treatment. A common mistake is to see a child with asthma and give more and more treatments because they don't seem to be responding. Most children with asthma don't need multiple medications, and yet the numbers you see who have been on multiple medications for a long period of time before anybody's asked the question why is quite high.
It's important to address also environmental exposures in patients with severe asthma. In childhood onset asthma, we need to take into account the possibility of allergic severe asthma. For patients with adult onset severe asthma, where the asthma started only in adulthood, we always need to take into account the possibility of occupational asthma. The advances we have made within severe asthma is mainly thanks to the better understanding of the disease, the heterogeneity of severe asthma, the different clinical phenotypes, and also then the understanding of the underlying immunological mechanisms, so the endotypes. And if you can link the clinical phenotypes with the underlying immunological endotypes, you know perfectly how to target these severe asthma phenotypes and endotypes.
Over the last 20 years, we've now come to appreciate that there's at least a subgroup of patients with severe asthma, probably the majority of patients in the end, who have an underlying Th2 or type 2 inflammation. And this type 2 inflammation is specifically responsive to type 2 targeted therapies. Unfortunately, in the old days, when these drugs were actually begun to be investigated in patients with asthma. They were used to treat all comers with asthma, and they didn't work. And there were multiple studies, examples of this, where you had a good drug, but given to the wrong population, and so no improvement, everyone threw up their hands, what are we doing, we have no idea. When in fact it really took just bringing the right patient to the right drug, and that really led, I think, to a paradigm shift in our ability to understand and treat severe asthma. And we've moved now with blood eosinophils being the simplest measure to obtain available on any CBC, complete blood count, with a differential, to adding a few more potential biomarkers. And again, those still require investigation, but things like exhaled nitric oxide, which is also easily measured, measured in exhaled breath of patients, can also help to guide therapy.
I suppose the therapy, which is relatively new, would be the anti-IgE agent omalizumab. And certainly in children, we've seen children who've been in and out of hospital on steroids, bad asthma attacks, and the attacks then disappear. That has delivered a huge improvement in quality of life. Our biggest gap is really understanding basic mechanisms. We know, for example, that severe therapy-resistant pediatric asthma, some patients have no eosinophils at all to be found, others are very eosinophilic. We don't know the pathways driving either condition. We know that it's not type 2 inflammation in many cases of the eosinophilic agents, but we don't know what is doing it. That's the big gap, because until we know what the pathway is, we cannot provide designer treatments to tackle it.
Ilse is a 32-year-old lady, and she started to have complaints of shortness of breath and cough at the age of 18, 22.
Dat is ongeveer nu 10 jaar geleden zijn die eerste klachten opgekomen. En dat was echt ja, heel kortademig, veel hoesten, vaak ziek, luchtweginfecties. Ja, 's nachts niet goed kunnen slapen, dan hoorde dat zo piepen. Heel moeilijk adem kunnen halen, ook ja, bijna niets meer kunnen doen. Ja, je voelt je daar absoluut niet goed bij. Hè? Ook voor jezelf is dat zo van, ja, nu kan ik dat al niet meer. En ik ben eigenlijk nog maar 25 of 30 jaar. En je moet zoveel gewone dagdagelijkse dingen.
It took 6 months before the diagnosis of asthma was made. Soon after, it became clear that despite treatment with inhaled corticosteroids, long-acting beta-2 agonists, all these inhaled therapies, that she had severe asthma, which was not well controlled despite this treatment. She had repetitive exacerbations of asthma, and she needed chronic maintenance treatment with oral corticosteroids, with a lot of side effects.
Ja, dan had ik heel veel ja, puffers nodig natuurlijk. En ook ja, echt wel cortisonepillen, elke dag, dagelijks. En dan om de zoveel weken had ik wel een opstoot of een infectie en was het echt wel nodig om die dosis dan ook op te drijven.
And then she was referred to the university hospital where I work, and she received add-on treatments with the monoclonal antibody anti-IgE omalizumab, which was at that moment available, but she did not respond to this treatment. But since 6 months, she receives active treatment with anti-IL-5 monoclonal antibody, which is now reimbursed in Belgium. And since this treatment, she has no complaints of asthma anymore. She does not suffer any exacerbations anymore. And we were able to reduce the dose of oral corticosteroids.
Het is een wereld van verschil. Het is, ja, fietsen gaat terug, wandelen gaat terug, boodschappen doen is geen probleem meer. Ook werken is terug, ja, gaat een pak vlotter, uiteraard op uitstap gaan. Ga shoppen of een keer afspreken, een volledige dag plannen. Een pretpark of een uitstap, een volledige, dat lukt nu echt wel weer zonder problemen, zonder dat er noodmedicatie nodig is. Het is fantastisch. Ik ben zeer tevreden.
She is still on inhaled corticosteroids and long-acting beta-2 agonist, but hopefully in the next months we will be able to stop even the oral corticosteroids, because these oral corticosteroids, they provoke a lot of side effects in the long term.
The future is very exciting for severe asthma. There's been huge increases in our ability to analyze big data, as it were. So now we have ability to synthesize molecular signals from RNA-seq sort of expression data in epithelial brushings, in sputum, in BAL cells, in blood, and to compare these results to clinical parameters, to compare protein expression on cell surfaces with new technologies called CyTOF, where you can measure multiple different proteins all at once on cell types, to single cell analysis. The technology is exploding. And because I think we have a background of a reasonable understanding of severe asthma and its mechanisms, these tools are much more easily applied, I think, in the asthma space than they might be in other areas where the underpinnings of our understanding are actually a little less.
We need to have rational discussions with the public about how we're going to fund these new treatments, who we're going to fund them for, what constitutes value for money, and also ask the sharp ethical question, is it ethical to test new medications in a population who are not going to be able to afford them?
We need education to the lay public, to the patients, to the primary care physicians, and also to our colleagues, respiratory physicians, that the landscape of the treatment opportunities for severe asthma has changed dramatically in recent years and will further improve in the coming years.
So I'm very, very positive about what's coming along the line. We've got to make sure we get the basics right in the children, because there's clearly no point in giving a new biological to somebody who isn't taking standard treatment and would respond to standard treatment. And we're going to need to find ways of funding these.
Even with this great advancement in the type 2 targeted biologics, that there's still going to remain a good portion of patients with severe asthma who are not going to be treated by these biologics, and that more research really is needed in those patients. We're finding that there's a huge overlap in patients who've had a diagnosis of asthma, meet all the criteria for asthma, who seem to have an underlying autoimmune process. Until we understand that somewhat bizarre connection between asthma and an autoimmune disease, we probably are not going to have the correct therapies for those patients. So it's an exciting time. We're going to improve the lives of many, many people, but clearly there's still going to be a portion of patients where considerable more research is needed.